stand. Let's sing.
There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I know that it's the Spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face, and I know they feel the presence of the Lord. Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet Heavenly Dove, stay right here with us, filling us with your love. And for these blessings, we lift our hearts in praise. Without a doubt, we'll know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place.
Oh, you sound so good this morning. Good morning, Pastor.
Good morning, Pastor. Good morning, church. It's so good to be back with you. I know that for some of you who are visitors may not be aware, I've been away for the month of July doing a little bit of healing, which I'll talk about in just a bit. But thank you for that gift, and it's wonderful to be back among you. I've missed you so much and look forward to being back for many, many weeks.
Absolutely.
So if you are a visitor, I'm Pastor Marcia, not the visiting pastor, but the one that should have been here all along. And this is Pastor Kenny, who so capably has been taking care of things while I've been gone. Also, Brenda, our accompanist. And I'll talk more about that in a minute, too, about how much I appreciate
Absolutely.
That, Kenny.
Absolutely. It was a real team effort. And it's great. We burned this place down and rebuilt it before you got back. We're just delighted you're here. As a matter of fact, why don't you take a moment and turn to those closest to you and hug a neck, shake a hand, let them know how delighted you are to see them this morning.
Good, good to see you. Good to see you. Yeah. Y'all doing all right?
We're doing all right.
All right, all right. Hang on. Hey, Annie. Hey, I may need some batteries. We have any, too?
Thank you.
can be seated if you'd like. Don't they sound wonderful?
They sound wonderful. I think Deb Core is left-handed or something. I've got this, Deb, I've got this speaker in my wrong ear. I know Deb preached last week, so let me get it under here. There we go. All right. It was so good to see those many new faces and all of our family faces. So good to see you. A lot going on, and I do want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. We had a great Bible school. Saw
Absolutely,
those pictures.
Yes.
Saw, you know, 15, 16, 17, 19 kids.
How many of you were part of Vacation Bible School?
You were part of Vacation Bible School. Raise your hands. Thank you so much for that. Amazing. We really, really believe and try to live out at Bluegrass, getting beyond our walls. And beyond our walls we've been this summer. Pride festivals all over central Kentucky, which has been amazing. July 4th parade, I saw that presence. And yesterday, did we build a house? Help build a house, Liz? Several of you all, who are y'all involved in the Habitat build yesterday? That's amazing, too. Thank you so much for that. And I tell you what, church just goes on, and it's a wonderful thing. You know, pulled in this morning, Kenny, the grass was mowed. You know, I don't know if the building was rebuilt or not, but we certainly got new stained decks that looked amazing. I know Morgan and some folks worked on that. Just so many things happened in the day-to-day and the week-to-week services of the trustees and the elders and the council. You all don't know how much it meant to me for y'all to be just carrying on this beautiful church family while I was gone. So thank you all so very, very much.
Absolutely. It truly is a family and a team. You should.
Absolutely. And we still got things going on with planning.
Absolutely.
So next week, elders will meet at 5:30, and council will follow that up at 6:30 to continue with our planning for the rest of this year.
On August 13th.
And caring for the kids. It's a new thing we started as an extension of our former just Backpack Only program. And this year, we're going to really get involved with Coventry Oaks, Booker T. Washington, and Leestown Middle School, and giving them even more support. We're already getting some requests for some really essential things that kids need, such as shoes and beds and things like that that they really need. Kids sleeping on the floor and some things like that. And we always say, not on our watch if we can help it. So
Absolutely.
We'll be hearing more information about that coming up too.
And we have a website, the web address for Caring for the Kids. Do you have that on the top of your head?
I don't. And Troy would get me for that. But
well,
caringforthekids.org, I think. Yeah, but we'll get it on our on our Facebook page.
We were prepared for that little moment. And then, of course, there's always NOSH. We truly believe, we say this every Sunday, but we sincerely believe that no one should ever be hungry. So we do what we call NOSH. No one stays hungry. And we have food that's available for you after church. Just pick it up on your way out. And then we've decided, the church council decided a few weeks ago to expand on that. And so you've noticed a big blue barrel that's sitting out in the entryway when you come in. And as you're out and about shopping, you can pick up maybe a bag of beans or a can of something, some non-perishables, and you can bring those to church with you on Sunday morning and drop them in that big barrel. And we're actually getting a food bank together, and just very shortly, we're going to be able to offer folks not just a meal on Sunday mornings, but something they can take with them and give them some nourishment and some food through the week. We feel like it's something that we can do as a family, for our family and for our community. We all have that sphere of influence and people that we touch, so hopefully that'll be a blessing.
And folks that stop by sometimes on Sunday morning and need some food, we want to be able to give them a bag of food for the week, so that
Absolutely.
Will sustain them. Absolutely.
Absolutely. Let's pause, deep breaths, and let's sing about that beautiful, sweet Spirit.
Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet Heavenly Dove, stay right here with us, filling us with your love. And for these blessings, we lift our hearts in praise. Without a doubt,
open the spaces that get crowded in by the challenges of our lives.
Teach us to trust your living spirit.
working in us and through us.
Clear out the distractions and the noises of those voices that compete with your voice.
Remind us to rely on your presence as our guide, our comfort, our assurance.
In this time together, let us engage fully with you and with one another.
Here we are, holy God, ready, willing, able, and listening.
Let's pray. Good morning, God. We love you. And we thank you. And what an honor it is to be able to know you and to be called one of your own. We thank you, God, that you loved us first. And we get to return that love, whatever form it looks like. And this morning, it comes by way of us just being here to sing and to worship, to love and to learn and to feel, to be in your presence and to be among one another. God, we ask you to be with us in this service, in these few minutes together, especially, to encourage us and to recharge us and to energize us and to help us focus on you and the parts of our world that need you most. Use the songs, the words, the prayers, the call, the notes on the instruments. Use it all to accomplish all of those things, because we know when we're fed and led by those things, we're better people, we're better members of the family and the community, and we're better neighbors and co-workers and friends. We'll treat this world the way you intended it to be treated. We ask these things in your name, and all who believed and agreed said, amen.
Amen.
Would you stand with us this morning as we sing our opening hymn, a wonderful old song, Great is Your Faithfulness.
Thousand beasts.
Amen. You may be seated. Any kids here? I don't know if Isabel wants to come up today. No? All right. Well, we'll just have Brenda move over. That'll be fine. I know that we sang, not yet though, Brenda. How about that? I do realize that we sang Great Is Your Faithfulness last Sunday. Brenda reminded me of that, this Brenda. And Deb, I think we share that too as one of our very, very favorite hymns. And selfishly this morning, not only to go along with the sermon, but for what's in my heart, that reminder that God is always faithful, always by our side, and remains with us no matter what goes on in our life, good and bad. Amen? Amen. So as we think about that and we share together every week joys and concerns, I have been keeping up somewhat, at least on Facebook posts, the things that's on your heart. I haven't commented a lot. Many of you know me know that I'm a fairly heavy user normally of Facebook, but in the past several weeks, I have really been away from most all of that. And actually, that's not actually a bad thing, I'm finding. But I have been a little disconnected with everything going on with you all, so I'm interested this morning first of maybe what's making your heart sing. I again want to say thanks for so many who were here week after week, especially Deb for preaching last Sunday. Daniel was here doing the music, and Kenny was capably stepping in to preach, and Brenda was being her constant talented person here. So thank you again. That's such a joy. What's making your all's heart sing this morning? Anything you're happy about you want to share with your family? Rita? And that's a happy thing because we're supporting folks that need that support. And Rita, we continue to thank you for doing that. So thanks so much. Others? Yeah, Lynn.
Seeing you in the pulpit.
Oh, thank you so much. Me as well. Yeah, Bob.
I'm so grateful and glad that we had a good turnout yesterday for teenagers. I'd like to remind everybody again, it's always going to be the first Saturday of each month.
First Saturday of each month. Now, they moved that. I talked to Bob about that today. And I said, Bob, I thought it was going to be the last. He said, we're too old to remember that. So we're just going to say the first Saturday, and it's called Teenagers, and all are invited. It's for the group. They call themselves that because they've seen it all. But you're invited to come. It's a potluck. Is that right?
Yeah, potluck. Church will provide
the chicken. The chicken and stuff. A good time.
I also like to just have everybody remember problems.
Absolutely.
Every week I see more stuff, you know, coming up and people dying. It's just terrible out there.
It really is, absolutely. Our new friend, yeah.
I thank God that I finally found a church that I'm comfortable in, because I've been to several and I haven't felt like this before, and I just want y'all to know I'm very comfortable where I'm at.
Well, we're thrilled to have you. I talked to you all this morning. I think third Sunday you're all here, and we're thrilled to have you. Thrilled to have you. Indeed. Yes.
This is Simeon, a newcomer.
Hi, Simeon. How are you?
I'm doing blessed. I was here with you all. I visited you all last Sunday.
Yes, sir.
And what I'm blessed for is last Sunday I was blessed to be here. I wasn't in the congregation, though, but I was homeless. And I was blessed enough this month to find an apartment in my rain. And hopefully I'll be here.
Well, listen, brother, you're not by yourself anymore. Let me tell you that, okay? We're thrilled to have you here. And as you find out more about your apartment, you let us know how we can help. And they have a pastor here that has a terrible back. That'd be me. But we have a lot of folks in here that have good backs. So we'll make sure we can help you however we can, okay, Simeon? Nice to have you. Liz, Karen, I know you all have something to celebrate, a new house. Congratulations to that.
Yes, we do have our new place set up. Still unpacking, but it's going to be a process. I also do want to say, please put in your prayers for my little sister again. She has some tremors going on, and we're not sure what's causing it yet.
Tell me your sister's name again, Liz.
Rose.
Rose, okay.
It's Christian's mom.
Yeah, Steph.
We're getting to about the time where I'm starting to apply for a lot of science policy fellowships. most of them are going to be starting next year, but there's one in particular, which is 3 months long, and if I got it, it would take me to D.C. from January to April. So I'm really excited to apply for it, but I'm also really nervous. So.
Sure. Thoughts and prayers as you do that. Maybe you can straighten them up out there in about 3 or 4 months, huh? If you get that way. Yes, sister.
I'm joyful for simply waking up this morning. I had a very close friend pass 3 days ago.
I'm sorry.
I miss him dearly.
What's your friend's first name?
Aries.
Sorry to hear that, friend. Daniel.
My friend John is coming home from Pittsburgh in the next day or so. He didn't get approved to get the liver transplant, and the doctors have told him that he's basically got a 10% chance to survive. So just prayers as this journey continues. It's a possibility that down the road he may be able to, but he's really, really sick. So I'm not sure when that will happen, but just prayers as these transitions happen. And for Jesse, his husband, and his family, he's got 6 sisters that are kind of reeling from dealing with all of this.
Absolutely. Tough journey. Pray for that. Others. Stanley.
Hey, I just want to say thank the Lord for everything he does for me. I have a couple of friends at work, Amy, her boyfriend has cancer, and another friend, Danny, and his girlfriend has cancer. So we lift them up and pray for them.
Writing them down, my brother. Thank you, Stanley. Others? Yeah, Brandy.
I have a friend at work named Jerry. My mom just had gallbladder surgery, but she's not doing very well. So
your friend's name is Jerry?
Jerry, yeah.
Okay.
So prayers for her family and for her mother.
Okay.
Recovered nicely. And then also, they're starting to close, they've been closing the Rite Aid recently and a couple close by. So we can pray that.
Absolutely. I know you worked really hard for that, so yeah. Yeah.
I forgot. I wanted to pray for my daughter. She had MS, and she's been having it for about 8-9 months now.
What's your first name, honey?
Latasha.
Thank you. Others. I'll get you a meal as well, Josh. That's tough. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Monica.
I just want to ask for prayers for Ray. Since she can't really communicate, we've been through some big changes lately. She starts a new daycare tomorrow. I just hope that everything is a little ahead of hers and that's okay.
Absolutely. I know she's got some loving parents. And many of you, I think most of you know that Billy and Monica have relocated to Berea for a great opportunity for Billy, and it's a transition for the whole family. Monica's spent a lot more time on the road and raised in transition, so prayers as y'all continue this transition. We're thrilled you're still part of us. We're not letting anybody down Berea steal you yet. Liz. Anything else? Yeah, Stanley?
When I was coming to church this morning, I was at the transit station and see all the homeless people there, and it really breaks my heart to see that. We need to pray for these people. They're having a hard time.
Absolutely. You know, and though we don't know them by name, God does, and so we will ask for God's presence to be felt in special ways. Let us prepare our hearts for prayer, church.
Incline thine ear to us.
gracious God.
Thank you so much for all that you are to us.
A presence that is always felt and is always promised, no matter who we are or where we are on life's journey. God, we come to you this morning from different paths. Some of us sort of came in this morning with happiness and joy and a little energy in our step from lives that are going well right now, and we are so thankful for the good days and for the joy that we have. Teach us, oh God, to pause every day and be thankful for the life and the day and the very breath that you give to us. To never take that for granted. And we are so thankful that there are many in our midst this morning who have done just that. As we ask for joys and concerns, they lifted up the joy of life. We thank you for this beautiful day and for all the opportunities and promise that lie ahead of us in these hours of this very day. We thank you for the fellowship of this church, a church that we really want to be that place of welcome and that feeling of home, a church that's a safe place for us to be who we are and not have to pretend. Where there's no particular way to believe or dress code or rules or doctrines, but it's just a place where we come together seeking to know you better, seeking to be better in the world. May we be that church, oh God, that goes beyond our walls to care for those with addictions, those who are without home, those who are lonely, afraid, anxious. And God, just as we pray for them, we know the importance of that. We also ask that you put before us opportunities to put those prayers into action in ways that we can help. And God, we pray as this school year begins to get started again and we have on our mind our kids and families that are at risk. Help us know how to help them best, whether that's feeding them on weekends when there's no free or reduced lunch at school, whether that's providing support to parents who are struggling with under or unemployment or just transitions of raising kids, whether that's helping tutor or offer friendship to a child who feels like there's no hope. We just ask, oh God, you continue to lead us and give us your courage to follow your guide, even when it might not seem possible to us or seem difficult. For we know that since the beginning of this church, oh God, you have always been at least one step ahead. God, we do pray for all those things we brought as concerns. For those in our network of friends and family who have illnesses, be they chronic or acute, for those facing things like MS and cancer, for friends who are having difficult medical journeys that they can't see their way out of. We continue to pray for our friend Chelsea and Marcus on their medical journey. And for all those we lifted this morning, we know in lifting those names, they have been lifted from our hearts to you. And God, we are just as assured that everything in our hearts that we didn't lift, you know those as well. So in these moments, we just lift up to you those names and those concerns that we come here this morning, either wrestling with in some way, or burdened by. So we're going to lift those up to you just right now, silently where we are. Gracious God, as we continue in our service, we ask that you help us to listen, that you allow we allow you to speak to us so that we can know in our lives and in our hearts what you'd have for us to do and who you'd have for us to be. It is so hard sometimes to push away all the distractions and busyness of the world, all the challenges that can mire us down. So we ask, oh God, that you just free us in these moments to bust our hearts and our minds wide open so you can show us who we are and teach us who you want us to be. We know you hear our prayers, and now we ask for you to lead us in this day and in the days ahead. Amen.
While Jesus and his disciples were traveling, Jesus entered a village where a woman named Martha welcomed him as a guest. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his message. By contrast, Martha was preoccupied with getting everything ready for their meal. So Martha came to him and said, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to prepare the table all by myself? Tell her to help me." The Lord answered, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. One thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the better part. It won't be taken away from her."
So I have this list. It's a list that I choose not to bring out perhaps as often as I should. For it is a list of challenges and shortcomings. It's a list of my mistakes and misjudgments and character flaws. And frankly, it's a list that I wish was not quite as long as it is. And yet today's scripture encourages me to just pull the list out and reflect upon it. Today's scripture indeed is one of those that hits this pastor right between the eyes, which might make you wonder why I chose to use it this morning. Our story starts as Jesus and his disciples went on their way. Jesus entered into a certain village. Now, this introductory sentence, those of you who've been around me a while know I like to break this scripture down. And the introductory sentence gives us two clues. First, Jesus and his disciples were on their way somewhere, and we find the answer to that question in the last chapter, chapter 9. It says that Jesus intently set his face to go to Jerusalem. We could gloss over that detail, but it is an important detail, for the significance here is that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem, which you might know means that Jesus was on his way to the cross. He was on his way to die. For that sort of puts a spin on everything else that will follow. Second, where was this certain village that Jesus entered? Well, Luke doesn't tell us, but the Gospel of John tells us that the name of the village was Bethany, and that Bethany was, in fact, near Jerusalem. And we know further from John's writing that Martha and Mary have a brother, Lazarus, and that shortly before Jesus' death, Jesus had this miraculous encounter with Lazarus, raising Lazarus from an old life to a new one in one form or another. And so it seems that we can safely assume that this drop by Jesus in Martha and Mary's home wasn't just this random thing. No, indeed, it seems like that it was just like we would stop and see a friend on our way through town. For the scripture also says, John says that Jesus loved all three of them, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. So we see this picture. Martha welcomes Jesus into the house and sort of would remind me of my mom, welcomes someone into the house, and immediately my mom is in the kitchen. Just as Martha went to the kitchen to fix dinner. Mary, though, Martha's sister, as we listened to what Daniel read, she did not go to the kitchen to help, but instead she sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. Now that seems okay, but it wasn't okay with Martha. Luke says Martha was distracted with much serving. Do you know how that might feel? Have you ever experienced being in over your head? Distracted with much work. You wanted help, you needed help, didn't know where to turn to get it. I've been there. In fact, I'm a lot like Martha. I like to work, and I usually pitch in and do my part. I like to say it's because I'm helpful, but the truth is that I'm impatient and don't think anybody can do it as well as I can. Sometimes I end up working while others sit around chatting. Maybe, like me, you know how Martha must have felt that day. Martha, angry at being abandoned in the kitchen, came to Jesus and said, "Lord," and now don't miss that word. It was the first word out of Martha's mouth, so that acknowledges who she thought Jesus was. Not just any friend, but Son of God, special. Calling Jesus Lord, a name that clearly indicates her belief in who he was. So we say, good job, Martha, on that. But then, notice, right after she acknowledged Jesus as Lord, she rebukes him. How dare her? She says, "Jesus, don't you care? My sister's not helping." She gives Jesus an order. "Tell my lazy sister to get in the kitchen to help me." Now, the scripture doesn't say that. I know I took liberty there in that interpretation. But that's probably what she meant, isn't it? That kind of outburst, I can imagine how that made folks in the room feel. If you're Mary, you're thinking, "Martha, come on, you know, it's Jesus. Could just tell me you need some help. I'll help you out." And if you're Jesus, Jesus is like, "This is awkward." See, I'm sympathetic to Martha. Sometimes I get angry when I feel I'm doing all the work. And I've certainly said a few angry words in my life, very much like Martha did. Having been there and done that, then I know what Martha could have done differently, indeed what she should have done differently. I've preached a number of sermons on this scripture, Kenny, over the years, but I always struggle with it because I am more like Martha than Mary. And I want someone to appreciate Martha and those of us who are like Martha. And as I continued studying for this morning, it suddenly occurred to me how Mary's relationship and her focus on her relationship with Jesus was so right, and how Martha's anger was so disruptive. Jesus agreed with that, by the way, for Jesus said, "Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed. Mary has chosen the good part, which will not be taken away from her." As I say those words, I feel sorry for Martha. I want Jesus to commend Martha for her work. I want him to say, Mary, let's go both in there and let's give Martha a hand. But Jesus says, Martha, Martha, you're anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing's needed. And Mary has chosen the better part. Is there anything in this story for us this morning, friends? I believe there is. We are such busy people, and we live in such a busy world. It is so easy to miss the important things. The story of Martha and Mary here tells us that there's a value in sitting, in listening, in learning, and in loving. Like Martha, so many times we think that the important thing is doing, but Jesus teaches us to just sometimes sit and listen and learn and love. It's been a tough, tough year for Brenda and I. In fact, as I reflect upon things, this 8-month stretch may have been the toughest I have ever endured in my life. Finding out in mid-January that our best friend Peggy's cancer had spread to her brain, and then losing her on March 19th after the honor of helping care for her around the clock for 2 months. Losing my dear friend, Nick Park, to an overdose. Exactly 31 days after Peggy's death, my 39-year-old niece, who's like a daughter to me, was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. And only 80 days after that diagnosis, Jennifer died in our home. In fact, in our bed. A mixed blessing, because that's where Jen asked to be. And yet it has been difficult for Brenda and I in that aftermath and the rest of our family. Since Jen's death on July 7th, it's been a whirl of grief. Both from losing Jen and Peggy, because what we knew and now realize in true fashion is we didn't have time to adjust and grieve Peggy's death before we moved into caretaking with my mom and others for Jen. And brothers and sisters, I got to tell you, that's a deja vu that I'd just soon never, ever repeat again. It has been a very, very tough 2018. And as I reflect on the tendency to be a Martha and add to where I find myself in these past several weeks, I am now leaning into Mary. I'm leaning into these lessons of Mary given by the words of Jesus. When Jesus said, Mary, you're listening. You're doing what's important. Spending time with me, hanging on to my words, and soaking in my presence with you. Which again, remember, friends, was especially important on this visit because this would be Jesus' last visit with them. The next time they see Jesus may have been at his crucifixion. We don't know for sure who was there to watch Jesus die, but from reading and studying all of the 4 gospel accounts, they all say that, quote, many women watched from a distance. And more than one Mary is mentioned specifically. So we don't know whether it was this Mary and Martha, if they were there when Jesus died. But what we know for sure is that this visit, this stop and visit by Jesus with Martha and Mary, was an important visit. It was the last time they would hear Jesus' voice. It's the last lesson they would learn firsthand. It's the last time they'd feel his physical presence without any doubts. I know what it felt like in those last days with Peggy and Jen. It was a plethora of emotions. so, so difficult, knowing what was coming around the bend and seeing them slip away bit by bit, day by day, indeed hour by hour. And yet, opportunities to say anything and everything that seemed most important, and not leaving any stone unturned or any gesture or words unresolved. It wasn't important how the house looked, messy or not. It wasn't important if food was in the kitchen or not. Any of the other trivial things that I sometimes get so caught up about just didn't matter. Those trivial things were so unimportant. Ah, but the time we had left to spend with our precious loved ones, that was the good part. That is the part that can never be taken from us. Now listen, I fully realize the temptation here. And I'll just bet at one point in your life or another, maybe even now, you've been right here with me. See, we go through these life checkpoints, don't we? And we seemingly learn lessons only to return to life as normal. I know that my Martha tendencies won't magically disappear just because I've had a tough 8 months. And just because I've lost two people so incredibly close and important to me. Indeed, even as I prepared to return back to the pulpit this morning, my tendency was to jump right in, start doing my spreadsheets, Brenda and Kenny, send them to you, prepare for weeks ahead. It's not that there's a problem with that. I'm sure they're going to appreciate at some point me kicking back in and doing some planning. But honestly, as I literally got out and sorted everything out to begin doing that, I heard this voice telling me that I needed to listen to the sermon I was preparing for this morning. Things that matter to my spiritual being. The things that matter to the spiritual depth of our church family. You see, friends, I could change one letter from a T to an S, and it will eerily read, Marcia, Marcia, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen the better part. So as I return this morning as your pastor, I ask for your prayers. As I attempt a better balance of being versus doing, a better way of listening before acting, which will not only go a long way towards self-care, but it should make me a better person, a better wife, a better daughter, and a better aunt, and a friend, and a better pastor, who's clinging to the good things that can't be taken away by tragedies like death or unimportant things like trivial critiques from those who are acting a whole lot more like Martha. Friends, the truth is, whether we're at home or at work or at school, our call and indeed our challenge is to take moments to look around and find the blessings. Take moments to thank God for giving us another day. To sit at God's feet for just a moment. To be quiet amidst this crazy world. To treasure the moments we have with one another, with those we love, and with those we need to love. The truth is, we live in a Martha world. but perhaps we should take some time to be merry for just a bit. For Jesus tells us that's the one thing that's needed. Jesus says, time with God. That's the good thing. That's the good part that cannot be taken away. If we believe that and we take that advice, then I think our guest services will be much more like Mary and much less like Martha. Sure, there might be less work in the kitchen. I welcome that. And there might be less food to go around. But I'm reminded of this, friends. The same person who gave us this advice turned loaves and fish into food for thousands. So it's my guess that when we take time to savor time with the living God known best to us as Christians in the life and example of Jesus, there's going to be plenty to go around. And all we receive will be the good part. The good part which can never be taken from us. I don't know about you, but I'm sure counting on that these days. Especially these days. And I believe that you can count on it as well.
Great is your faithfulness, O God, Creator. There is no shadow of turning with you. Lord, you change not your compassions, they fail not. Lord, you have been and forever will be. Great is your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
Well, I've had a lot of bread since I've seen you last. Haven't done quite so well on my carbs. But the truth is, I haven't had any of this bread. And I've missed it. I've missed being at this table with you. If there's something special about this, yeah, the Hawaiian bread's in the Kroger aisle or the Walmart aisle or whatever aisle it is. I don't want to get in trouble for that. But there's something special when it gets to this table. And what makes it special is what it represents. The inclusive, wildly radical love of God for every single one of us. The welcome that's here, where there's plenty for all of us, and then some. Where we are assured of God's faithfulness and God's presence. And so we gather at this table, clinging onto that assurance. Let's sing that faith.
Come on.
Gracious God, we come here together at this table as brothers and sisters in you, thankful for your love and for your grace, counting on your presence to sustain us in all our days ahead. God, we thank you for your faithfulness over and over again in our lives. Remind us, Holy God, to step away indeed from the chaos and the pace of life, to simply be, so that we can listen and learn just as Mary did. Remind us, O God, to value those treasured moments, the things that can never be taken away from us, that is our time and our memories. We are thankful for those times and memories with those we love. And we are thankful for the time we spend with you, O God. And we're thankful for the stories in Scripture that we read of your Son and our brother Jesus, who gives us that hope and who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Gathered with his friends on the last night that he would be eating with them, Jesus took a loaf of bread and he blessed it. Broke the bread to share with them. He said, take and eat. And every time you eat this bread, remember my life. Remember the lessons I taught you and the love that I've given to you. It indeed was an anxious group in that room. After supper, Jesus took a cup, for he was a Jew. And that was the Jewish custom. So he took the cup after supper and he blessed it as well. And he said to all of them who were so worried and afraid in the room, drink from the cup. And when you do, remember that this is my new promise, a new covenant I'm making with you. That though I leave you physically, I will never leave you spiritually. Jesus reminded them that night that he would always live in them and through them. So again, he said to them, as if they needed to be reminded more than once and more than twice, every time you gather and you eat and drink, remember my life and remember my promise. This morning, friends, whether this is the first time you've taken communion, or you can't count how many times, you are welcome. I've read all the gospel accounts of the Last Supper, and Jesus did not issue not even one rule. The table doesn't belong to a church or to a pastor. This is God's table, where all are welcome. So you're invited to take a piece of bread and after a time of meditation to drink from the cup. My brothers and sisters, it's my prayer that you will sense God's presence in a real way as you do so. Thank you. God, you have gifted us in many different ways. You have created us so uniquely and for a specific purpose. Our diligent prayer is that you reveal to us what your purpose for our life is and what your purpose for our church is. And however we give, with our time and energy, with our attendance and creativity, with our resources to provide for this church's witness in this community, however we give, our prayer is that our gifts will be used to be a light to our community. Our gifts will be used to remind us that what we give to you has already been given to us. Amen. I just love it. When Brenda saw the title of my service, my sermon was Guest Services, she sent and said, "Can I play Be Our Guest?" I said, "It's absolutely amazing." So thank you for doing that. It was great.
You know, there are a bunch of theater people in this room that just love that sort of thing.
We got something coming in the fall as soon as I start being Martha again.
Martha.
Friends, as we prepare to sing our closing hymn, maybe you've been thinking about joining our church officially. And for us, that just simply means you're saying this is a place you feel home and you want to be in covenant with us like folks are. It's not anything all etched in stone, and Ray can lead the way here, as she shows us. But if you'd like to do that as we sing our closing hymn, I'd be happy to meet you here at the front so we can share with the church how you'd like to be a member here. Let us sing together our closing hymn.
But we hate to leave, and the
Several weeks ago, Kenny, a sermon you preached has just stayed with me, and I want to thank you for that. And that is when you talked about the platinum rule. Treat others the way you would like people to treat the one you love the most. It has really stuck with me. Perhaps today, if anything sticks with you as you leave, and I told Kenny when we were up here after communion, and I said, I should have had you put on the slide instead of, Marcia, Marcia, you're being anxious and concerned. How many times have I heard, Marcia, 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 from the Brady Bunch, right? So as we leave, whatever your name is, mine happens to be Marcia. Marcia, Marcia, Marcia. You are concerned and anxious about many things. Take a lesson from Mary and be concerned about what matters most. Sweet little Ray. Friends, as we go out to the world, take time to listen to God, to how God might be speaking to you, for what you might need to hear, for the lessons you might learn. And above all, hold on to those things that can never be taken from us. And the most important of that is God's love.
Yes.
And God's faithfulness. We go in the world with that, showing the world who we are and what we can be. Amen.
Amen. Be blessed.